Hello, everyone. Welcome to Inconvenient Truths. I'm your host, Jennifer Zeng. From the era of China's reform and opening up, we have heard too many stories of foreign investors and Wall Street tycoons making a fortune in China, while stories of investment losses or misfortune are rarely mentioned. This is because both the Chinese Communist authorities tend to cover up unfavorable investment incidents and the individuals involved, out of a desire to save face, often choose to remain silent. Therefore, the story we are going to hear today is especially precious because it is a rare true story that is not often heard, and the protagonist of this story, in order to tell of the hardships encountered, has also gone through unimaginable difficulties. On March 8th of this year, a woman dressed in mourning clothes suddenly appeared outside the office of the chief executive of Hong Kong, holding a banner nearly 5 meters long, demanding that both the Hong Kong and the Chinese Communist government address an 11-year wrongful conviction of Hong Kong citizen Xu Xiaolan. So who is Xu Xiaolan, and what's the story behind this decade-long miscarriage of justice? The saga began in 2012.
突然到12年的时候，我在过这个罗湖关的时候，突然就被大陆海关那边，然后就逮捕了，算是逮捕了，然后就把我带到一个楼上做笔录，然后晚上也没有给我睡觉，就是突然的发生这样的事情，我没有办法跟孩子去打招呼都没有，然后就去到北京一个姓张的局长，他就最后可能都快要到4-5点钟的时候，他说徐小姐，我现在给你最后一次机会。他就说，你要再不说，我就让你跳进黄河也洗不清。
It turned out that the head of the Beijing Anti-Corruption Bureau hoped that Hong Kong businesswoman Xu Xiaolan would cooperate with them and admit to committing corruption along with Liu Heping, the general manager of Sino-Steel Logistics Tianjin Company, and others she had business dealing with. However, Xu Xiaolan believed she couldn't admit to something she hadn't done or falsely accuse others. Therefore, she firmly refused.
那我真的没想到，第二天他们就把我送去了看守所。
As a matter of fact, Xu Xiaolan's business dealings with Liu Heping and others already concluded in 2009. At that time, she had purchased a shipload of iron ore and iron ore powder from Thailand, which was transported to Tianjin and handed over to Sino-Steel Trading Company for sale. Sino-Steel Logistics Tianjin Company was responsible for freight forwarding. This shipment had actually arrived in China in 2008, but due to the global financial crisis at that time, market conditions were poor, so it wasn't sold until 2009, and it was sold at a loss. The total expenditure for the purchase was 7 million yuan, but only over 3 million was recovered, resulting in a financial loss. During Xu Xiaolan's detention, she authorized investigators to go to Hong Kong to check all her company's bank accounts. At that time, she was the general manager of Hong Kong Dongsheng's metallurgy company.
那然后查完了，其实银行所有的户口，包括所有的往来，没有任何的迹象我有勾结他们所谓的刘和平、王卓汉、刘德江这些人，是没有任何证据的。我在看守所，我经历了，就是说 我没有的见律师，我想见家里人都没有，人里面关了35个女性，里面有很多的小偷买淫的盗窃的，进到那里面真的就门一关你好像就与世隔绝了，真的那种恐怖，那种感觉我这一辈子我都忘不了。一个月几乎没有人出去，没有人出去，就只有一个小门小窗户，然后那是递食物进来的，说要枪毙人的时候在那个下面枪毙。郑女士，我真的，我告诉你，我这一辈子忘不了，就是那个晚上你会听到猫头鹰在那里哭，白天你只会听到乌鸦在那里叫，硬生生的，我们12个女人要轮流值班，要轮流值班，没有的休息的，休息不好的，睡觉的地方。睡觉的地方很少，而且冬天洗完衣服湿的，躺在铺在自己的身上，用你的体温把它护干，用你的身体把它护干。我好不想回忆这一段时光，真的。
However, since then, Xu Xiaolan has endured a long 11 years of imprisonment, suffering various forms of torment in places such as the Haidian District Detention Center in Beijing, the first detention center at the Beijing Women's Prison.
关到那里面不是每一个人都犯罪，真的，我今年已经足足12年我没有认罪，但是我经历了比犯人还长的经过。一个礼拜冲一次澡，然后一个礼拜洗一次衣服。
So what exactly are the official charges against 徐小兰？ Look at this.It is the verdict from the Haidian District Court in Beijing. This verdict document is 40 pages long, listing numerous pieces of so-called witness testimony evidence that can make one's head spin. The conclusion is that Xu Xiaolan instructed Liu Heping, Liu Dejiang, the general manager of Tianjin Metallurgical Import and Export Company, and Wang Zhuohan, the manager of the Ore Department and Sino-Steel Logistic Tianjin Company, to embezzle and sell over 2,000 tons of Indian iron ore powder belonging to Sino's Steel Trading Company. Since Sino's Steel Trading Company is a state-owned enterprise, they are considered to have embezzled state funds, committing the crime of corruption, and Xu Xiaolan is deemed the principal offender. Therefore, she was sentenced to 11 years in prison and ordered, along with Liu Heping and Wang Zhuohan, to pay back the money, which was over 2.3 million yuan. The verdict also says that to cover up the fact of corruption, Xu Xiaolan and others repeatedly transferred the iron ore powder that belonged to Xu Xiaolan several times to different locations until it got lost. So Xu Xiaolan and others should bear the consequences. So what does Xu Xiaolan herself say about this?
其实出货郑女士，我是不知情的，你明白吗？我在香港公司，我的客户，同意买这批货 ，OK， 我们谈好价格，你去检测这个货的质量，然后我同意多少钱成交，然后这个内贸的合同是由客户跟这个中干贸易公司来签。
So, Xu Xiaolan believes that even if they tossed her goods around until they were gone, it has nothing to do with her. Moreover, if they ruled that her own goods were lost, and that she was selling goods that were not hers, thus accusing her of embezzlement, then where did her own goods go? So in 2016, she commissioned a lawyer to file a civil lawsuit against Sino-Steel Trading Company, accusing them of losing her goods and demanding compensation for the loss. Either they return the 2,625 tons of iron ore powder, or they compensate her at market price. This is 徐小兰's civil complaint.
这个官司足足打了三年，打了三年。我的律师在19年把笔录拿给我看的时候，是对方的律师在庭上面说，我的货在09年卖了，就是他们指控我贪污的这批货。在09年已经去世，
怎么样？我还是搞不懂为什么这种情况能够涉及到跟贪污有关，因为货是您的，存在他那里，他帮您卖，也许他收一点佣金，对吧？然后客户把钱付给他们，他们付给您，然后您从中这个亏了一些钱，可能是这个价格的问题，这个怎么也算不上贪污啊。我怎么也搞不懂为什么会变成贪污了，因为这个钱这个货不是国家的，也不是别人的，是您自己的。That was a question I asked during the interview. At that moment, I truly couldn't grasp how selling one's own goods could be deemed corruption. So what was the result of this three-year-long lawsuit for compensation?
他们有跟我的律师还没有打到法院的时候，我的律师就收到了中干贸易的公司的律师的信，说他们同意赔钱，还没有打到法院的时候他就已经告诉我同意赔钱。但是我的律师来到监狱告诉我的时候，我哭了。 我打这个官司我不是为了要钱而打的，我是为了要还原这个事实的清白。
At this point, you might assume that 徐小兰 won the lawsuit since the lawyer of the other side had agreed to compensation. But what was the final verdict? Let's examine the judgment. This judgment is also very long, 14 pages altogether. First, let's look at the conclusion.The plaintiff's entire claim is dismissed. The case acceptance fee of 26,800 yuan is to be paid by the plaintiff. So what are the reasons for the rejection? Let's take a look at what the judgment says. This page is quite lengthy, so I won't read it all. In summary, it states that 徐小兰, the general manager of Hong Kong Dongsheng Company, purchased a total of 6,495 tons of iron ore from Thailand. This ore was then transported to Tianjin on March 30, 2008. In April 2008, Dongsheng Company signed a sales contract and a consignment agreement with Sino-Steel Trading Company. On July 29, 2009, 徐小兰wrote a letter requesting that the sales of over 3,800 tons of Thai lamp ore to Shanghai Mingyi Trading Company at a price of 420 yuan per ton. After these were sold on September 3rd, 2009, Sino-Steel Trading Company paid Dongsheng Company over 350,000 US dollars. Thus,The consignment agreement between the two parties was considered terminated. According to the judgment, the goods were sold and paid for. Therefore, there is no issue of compensation. Consequently, all of the plaintiff's claims were dismissed. Does anyone feel that something is off here? Let's revisit the passage I asked everyone to pay special attention earlier. Quote, to cover up the facts of embezzlement, Xu Xiaolang and others repeatedly transferred the Thai powder and disposed of it arbitrarily, resulting in the Thai powder now being untraceable and its whereabouts unknown, and they should bear the adverse consequences of this, unquote. It is important to note that this comes from the same court, the Beijing Haidian District Court, which issued the criminal judgment against Xu Xiaolang in 2013. Do you think these two judgments are completely contradictory? In fact, a close reading of the two judgments reveals numerous flaws, and aside from some so-called witness testimonies, there is no material evidence regarding how Xu Xiaolang embezzled funds or how she colluded with her alleged accomplices to launder the money. Even the witness testimonies are rife with contradictions. Take a look here. One witness testimony even claims that she cannot recall who prepared the financial details which was used as evidence against Xu Xiaolang. Is it really acceptable to consider something that one cannot recall as evidence? It sounds like a joke, right? Therefore, while I'm not surprised that there are numerous unjust cases in the courts of the Chinese Communist Party, I was still very surprised to see a case where two judgments from the same court completely contradict each other, showcasing such a low level of fabrication skill.
当时他们不肯安排这个证人出庭，他们所谓的说我勾结，当时法院他不肯安排他们出庭。那王卓翰开庭的时候，我是问他，王卓翰，我说起诉书说我指使你，换货，我有指使吗？那他在庭上面，我不知道这一段录像法院有没有保留，如果保留的话。 刚好我现在已经递交了这个申诉状，希望他能还在这里。王卓翰在庭上说：“徐小姐，你不是我的上司，我不被你指使。”Consider
this. Is the entire lawsuit not absurd? Xu Xiaolang was a businesswoman located far away in Hong Kong. What authority did she have to command several officials from state-owned companies to assist her in stealing items from the warehouses of state-owned enterprises in Tianjin? If those officials had intended to steal, they could simply have done so themselves and kept all the money. Wouldn't that have been easier? Even if they needed to use Xu Xiaolang's company to launder the illicit funds, Xu Xiaolang would, at most, be considered an accomplice. Moreover, throughout this entire ordeal, there has been no record or evidence of Xu Xiaolang paying those officials any bribes. Her crime has been established merely on the basis of a few people's baseless allegations. This is precisely why Xu Xiaolang has been fighting to overturn her conviction from the first instance judgment right up to the present day.
上诉真的很长，郑女士，我递交了这个一审，把他全部的这个谎言跟他的不实，我用了差不多足足三个月的时间，我才写完。 才能平复我，都是半夜里面，因为一个号里面有30多个女人，白天真的非常的吵。我只在半夜的时候，我靠着墙拿着笔去把它 还原这个案子。
那他们说您跟这个刘和平是吧，他们勾结，那这些官员他们判了多少年呢？他们判没有判？
刘和平的贪污罪是9年，王卓汉他是判3/5，因为王卓汉做了他们的一个污点证人，我是判的最重的，我没有公职。
那另外一个姓刘的官员判了多少？
刘德江他由始至终，我一审二审我要求他出庭，没有安排出庭，他也没有被判刑，他没有被判一天的，被我勾结的人一天刑没有判。所谓的勾结的人，第一，他们没有任何人承认拿了我的钱，或者是分到了赃款，整个案子除了我的公司收到了货款之外，收到的所有的都是进了公司的账号，我需要蓝也没有拿一分钱。
However, 徐小兰's appeal was rejected by the Beijing Intermediate Court due to her insistence on not pleading guilty. Her experience in prison was more challenging than for those who choose to plead guilty, and she had no opportunity for sentence reduction.
因为我不认罪，受到了很多不公平的对待，包括我的每月我的这个处遇，所谓的处遇就是我因为我不认罪，我的处遇只能在监狱消费60块钱。60块钱意味着我卖完，我要当时我卖完打电话的卡，卖完邮票，我连卖底裤卖卫生巾的钱都没有，真的，我写信求助林郑月娥。所以这条路真的是太艰难，不认罪的这条路太艰难。最后有一次我真的扛不住了，我的这里因为那里的水太脏，我的这个地方卡了结石，同时胆囊炎结石全部一下子来到这里，我去求救他们，我但是如果有安乐死我都希望真的让我快走吧，真的太痛苦了，而且还不给我开病假，不给卧床的那种。所以我在那里上厕所都没有地方洗手的，你吃饭你干嘛，真的是，哎呀，那一段经历我真的不想去说，就是我都不知道自己怎么熬过来的。在海淀看守所没有米饭吃的，那个菜都是飘的萝卜白菜，下面沉淀的都是沙子，太惨，就是一句话，太惨。在中转站冲凉洗澡，你上厕所都不能，都只能说地狱比他可能还会好一点。你白天几十个人站在你的面前，你排完便你还没得地方洗手，差不多一个礼拜去一次厕所，然后那个水那个杯子都没有，都是共用的那个杯子，水里面都是水碱，然后沉淀的都是头发那些东西。那个20多天真的是可以说是地狱吧，真的是地狱。服刑也是很惨的，因为我都不会干那些体力活，本身我的腰也就受过伤。那个二监区，我分在二监区是港澳台区吧，关了也有台湾人，我当时跟我下去还有同样一个香港人，他当时也是不认罪的。这个里面真的有很多不为人知的痛苦。